find that no matter what happens, the Lord is calling us to live a life of faith, a life of spirit. Start by looking at the scripture in 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 2. Paul is speaking to his disciple Timothy. Preach the word, he said. Be instant in season, out of season. Reprove, rebuke, exhort with all suffering and doctrine. And this is talking about his ministry. Preach the word, meaning live your life of faith, preaching, teaching. For anybody that calls themselves a Christian or that believes in Jesus, you know that we live a life, we do what we do, and there are seasons. There's good seasons and there's bad seasons. Actually, the wisest man that ever lived wrote about this, Solomon in Ecclesiastes. He said, to everything there is a season, and a time to every purpose under the heaven. Time to be born and a time to die. A time to plant and a time to pluck up that which is planted. A time to kill, a time to heal. A time to break down, a time to build up. A time to weep, a time to laugh. A time to mourn, a time to dance. A time to cast away stones and a time to gather stones together. A time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing. A time to get and a time to lose. Time to keep and a time to cast away. A time to rend and a time to sow. A time to keep silence and a time to speak. A time to love and a time to hate. A time of war and a time of peace. All these, of course, are opposites one to the other of what we would consider to be good and bad. Solomon wrote about this, knowing that everybody and to everything there is a season and a time to every purpose under the heaven. And this is true in God's economy of things, the way that He operates in our life. Sometimes we will have up moments and sometimes we'll have down moments. Sometimes you have a bad day and then the next day you have a good day. Sometimes you have a bad week. Sometimes you have a bad month. How many of you have ever had a bad month? Like the whole month is lousy. Sometimes you even may have a bad year. And I've had a couple of those. I've had certainly many bad months and weeks and days by the thousands. But I've had a lot of good days. And I've had a lot of good months and good weeks. Whatever the case, the Lord is telling us in our faith and the way that we live for Christ, we have to find a way to be instant or ready and functioning equally, whether we are up or down, whether we are in season and out of season. And so every one of us has to be able to deal with the off time. And the fact is that we live in seasons, and it seems that we're not in control of those seasons. It's like the weather. We live through seasons, and not so much here in Singapore. Basically, your seasons are the hot season and then the hot and wet season. That's pretty much it. There's no real cool season. But if you live in other zones, you know, there's spring, and then there's summer, there's winter, there's fall. You know, you have these different seasons that you go through, and as a result, things change, and it's really not under your control. You can't control the weather. You can't control the seasons. I found the same thing in Christ. That we can't control the elements that surround us. Sometimes it'll be easy, sometimes it'll be hard. But I've found that we can trust the Lord no matter what. And He will take us through everything. Even though we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, we don't have to fear the evil of a bad day or a bad week or a bad month or even a bad year. Some people have had bad decades. And some people have had good decades. But most of us, it's up and down. I want to talk about Elijah. Elijah was a great prophet of the Lord. He's considered by many as a mighty man of God. He fearlessly defended the word of God, the principles of God, at a time when Israel had wholeheartedly turned their back on God and began to worship false gods. They turned to the Baals. They developed a system of worship. And they perverted all that was of God and abandoned it. They transformed it into something else. And so they were not many. In fact, persecution rose so much in the time of Elijah that King Ahab and specifically Jezebel did away with many of the prophets of the Lord. They were murdering them. If it weren't for one prophet that hid a whole bunch of them in a cave, all of them would have been killed. And Elijah was in that time. And we know that Elijah was powerful. We know that Elijah did incredible things. And therefore, we can determine that Elijah had good days, good weeks, good months, powerful stories. And we're going to look at one of those, because we're also going to see that exactly following one of the best and highest moments of his life comes a really bad time in his life. And there are characteristics there that we can look at. It's going to be divided in two sections. First, part one is Elijah in season. And these are four things about being in season. Later, we're going to see part two is Elijah out of season. There are four things here about Elijah in season, but later on out of season, we have seven things. So why don't you do this like four negative seven part? Because it's the Bible. I can't help it. There's always going to, it says that only through much tribulation can we enter the kingdom. Elijah was in his brightest moment, as I said, and he had to go through these things. These are the four things. Let's start with the first one. We're in 1 Kings 18, verse 1. The chapter starts. It says, after a long time, in the third year, the word of the Lord came to Elijah. Go and present yourself to Ahab, that's the king, and I will send rain on the land. So Elijah went to present himself to Ahab. The first thing I point to here is that we are in communication with God. Clear communication when we're in a good season. When you're hearing clearly from God, that is, you're getting revelations, you're seeing signs in the trees, in the clouds. You know, when God speaks to you, it's obvious. And there's those wow moments like, wow, this can't be a coincidence. That's a hallmark of a good season. You're in season when it's easy to receive messages, it's easy to prophesy, it's easy to operate in the gifts of the Spirit. And there are times when it's like that and you are just, it seems like God is just standing right next to you, talking to you. And you're happy because of it. But you know that doesn't always work that way. And some people say, well, no, it does. You can always have that. Well, for 30 years, I've seen both sides. Sometimes it comes so clearly. At this point, Elijah is living with this clear communication with him. The word of the Lord comes to him. He hears from him. And it seems so easy in those times. And of course, this is a favorite time of life for us. But it goes on. The second thing we see is that when we're in a good season, we have respect and honor. Now, the famine was severe in Samaria. And you might say, well, what famine? Well, God caused the famine to come on Israel so that he could get their attention and bring them to repentance because they had turned from him. And so, by the mouth of the prophet Elijah, before this happens, Elijah actually goes and says that God is going to shut up the heavens and no rain will fall for a certain period of time, and then he goes away. Well, at first they just dismiss him as an idiot, but sure enough, from that moment, it stopped raining, and it got drier and drier and drier, and crops are drying up, and they are desperate. And now they are angry because Elijah has caused it not to rain, which really Elijah didn't. He just spoke the word of the Lord. It was God that made it happen. But he was respected and honored. Now before, at this time, when he was in this season of his life, Ahab had summoned Obadiah, who was in charge of his palace. Obadiah was a devout believer in the Lord. While Jezebel was killing off the Lord's prophets, Obadiah had taken 100 prophets and hidden them in two caves, 50 in each, and had supplied them with food and water. Ahab had said to Obadiah, go through the land to all the springs and valleys. Maybe we can find some grass to keep the horses and mules alive so we will not have to kill any of our animals. So they divided the land they were to cover, Ahab going in one direction and Obadiah in another. As Obadiah was walking along, Elijah met him. Obadiah recognized him, bowed down to the ground, and said, is it really you, my lord Elijah? Yes, he replied. Go tell your master Elijah is here. Like, he's confident. He's powerful. God's speaking to him. He's doing exactly what the Lord has told him. His life is going good as far as the life of a prophet is concerned. He's not in the group of those that are having to hide at that moment, but God is speaking and empowering him. And so therefore we see that he has respect. Obadiah respects him. Everybody respects the man of God, and that's a good thing. There's times in your life where you're going to feel like you're respected and everybody looks up to you and admires you. That's a good season. Thirdly, we see in him fearlessness and faith? Elijah said, as the Lord Almighty lives, whom I serve, I will surely present myself to Ahab today. So Obadiah went to meet Ahab and told him. And Ahab went to meet Elijah. Notice that he did not go to meet the king, but he made the king come to meet him. That's a lot of confidence. The king is the one in trouble. And the king is the one that is suffering in the famine. If you know the bits of the story that we're not going to cover, Elijah was doing just fine because God was feeding him with ravens, and there was a brook that was trickling and water was coming to him, and literally birds were carrying meat out into the forest, into that the Kidron Valley where he was hiding, and feeding him meat. I wish birds would bring me meat. But I want them, you know, plastic wrapped like a cold storage. I don't want my bird spit all over my meat. But if they could bring like a little cold storage bag with a steak in there, that'd be great. I mean, there are moments in my life where God has done such things for me. Not actually a bird carrying it, but it seems like it. Moments when I needed things and God was there. Especially in the good seasons. In the good seasons, there's provision. In the good seasons, there's easy hope and easy faith. Things are going wonderful. And you are fearless and strong. By the way, the first good season for the believer is like the first year when you first get saved. First get saved, it is your honeymoon in Christ, and He just bathes you with love and happiness. And this is what I always say. If you ever need a miracle, have a first-year believer pray for you. If I ever need healing, I find the youngest Christian that God is still wowing with and building His confidence. Look, you pray for me. And I honestly have been healed at times and have seen amazing things happen because these little ones asked. And people just 3 weeks old in the Lord, 4 weeks old, just received Christ. And I remember that moment also in the beginning of my experience with Jesus. Man, anything I asked for within the hour. It was miraculous. Anything. I needed a job. One time I was walking and praying, and I was walking back home. I just received Jesus. And on my way home, I said, God, I need some things. First of all, I need to find a good church. Secondly, I need a job. Because I don't have any money, and the reason I didn't have money is because I couldn't work in my former line of work any longer, which involved the selling of things that were illegal to sell. Enough said. I'm not going to go into the details. But, so I had no more income because I got saved. All that stopped. Anything that I was connected to or addicted to, you could say, instantly God healed my mind. I had actual brain damage. God healed it. I was a living miracle. Still am to this day. And at that moment, I was praying and I asked, I need a church, I need a job, and one more thing, Lord, I want a Bible. I want a nice Bible. I want a leather Bible, a black leather Bible with the gilded edge, the shiny edge on it, the ones that are flexible. I was very specific because up at that point, being it was a good season of my life and new in Christ, whatever I asked for, My sugar daddy would say, oh, baby, don't you worry about it, honey. I'll get you whatever you want. And anything I ask for, and I ask for that, I get home. And as soon as I arrive at the house from praying that prayer, walking, I open the door and the phone is ringing. There's no one there. I go running quickly to answer the phone. I answered the phone, and it was a relative of mine that said, hey. And they did not know what was going on in my life. But this aunt of mine said, hey, do you need employment? And I said, yes. I was just like 2 minutes before. I prayed that. Yes. Well, as a construction job that we're doing, I would like to employ you if you would be willing to work. I said, absolutely. Then she said, but there's just one thing. I said, what's that? She said, well, it starts tomorrow. I have to take you to the site, but it's Sunday, and I need to go to church. She was really reluctant to tell me because I was, before that, I was anti-Christian. I didn't like Christians. I mocked them and avoided them at all costs. And so she said, well, you have to go with me. You can, I guess, wait outside if you want, but we have to go to a church. And I said, great! And there was this silence on the phone. I said, that's wonderful. She said, is this Stephen? I said, yeah. This is Stephen. And so the next day she went, two of my prayers were already answered. And then I went to the church, and I remember walking in the church, and this was a great experience. When I was there, in the church, I'm just thinking, man, right after praying, God brought me to this great church. He gave me a job. Now the only thing missing is, and right when I thought it, somebody tapped my shoulder with an angry face, looking at me. And I said, yes. And they handed me a black leather Bible with a gilded edge and said, here. They looked angry. And it was like exactly what I described to the Lord. And it was a small size Thompson Chain Reference Bible. I still have it to this day, more than 30 years ago. I took the Bible in my hand and I said, thank you. And he was so angry. And he said, God told me to give it to you. And I said, oh, I said, well, you don't have to. He says, oh, no, I have to. And he said, and he told me like 5 minutes after I bought it. Bought it, that was like back then $80 for this Bible. And this is 1984, right? That's a lot of money in 1984. And he was so mad. But he obeyed the Lord. So anyway, that's my point. At those seasons, those good seasons, we're fearless. We have faith. Anything is possible. And we're excited. Now the story continues. Elijah went before the people and said, how long will you waver between two opinions? If the Lord is God, follow him. But if Baal is God, follow him. But the people said nothing. Then Elijah said to them, I am the only one of the Lord's prophets left. But Baal has 450 prophets. So get two bulls for us. Let them choose one for themselves and let them cut it into pieces and put it on the wood, but not set fire to it. I will prepare the other bull and put it on the wood, but not set fire to it. Then you call on the name of your God, and I'll call on the name of the Lord, the God who answers by fire. He is God. Then all the people said, what you say is good. So this is like a prophetic competition. You have prophets from both gods representing who can be authenticated by this act. And Elijah is saying, this is what we're going to do. And they said, that's a deal. We're going to do that. And so then all the people said, what you say is good. Elijah said to the prophets of Baal, choose one of the bulls and prepare it first. He let them choose which bull, in case they thought there was some kind of a tricky bull that could self-ignite. Self-combusting bovine, you know. I don't know if those exist, but he let them choose, and they did. Choose one of the bulls and prepare it first, since there are so many of you. Call on the name of your God, but do not light the fire. So they took the bull given them and prepared it. Then they called on the name of Baal from morning till noon. Oh, Baal, answer us, they shouted. But there was no response. No one answered. And they danced around the altar they had made. At noon, Elijah began to taunt them. Shout louder, he said. Surely he is a god. Perhaps he's deep in thought, or busy, or traveling. Maybe he's sleeping, and must be awakened. So they shouted louder, and slashed themselves with swords and spears, as was their custom, until their blood flowed. Midday passed, and they continued their frantic prophesying until the time for the evening sacrifice, but there was no response. No one answered. No one paid attention. But Elijah said to all the people, come here to me. They came to him, and he repaired the altar of the Lord, which was in ruins. Elijah took 12 stones, one for each of the tribes descended from Jacob, to whom the word of the Lord had come, saying, your name shall be Israel. With the stones he built an altar in the name of the Lord, and he dug a trench or a ditch around it large enough to hold 2 seahs of seed. Quite a deep trench. If you stood in it, it would be about to the middle of your thigh, all the way around. He arranged the wood, cut the bull into pieces, and laid it on the wood. Then he said, fill 4 large jars with water and pour it on the offering and on the wood. And remember, the competition is to see if either one could get it to ignite. And so he puts it on there and starts to douse it with water, saturating it. Then he says, do it again, he said. And they did it again. Do it a third time, he ordered. And they did it the third time. The water ran down around the altar and even filled the trench. At the time of sacrifice, the prophet Elijah stepped forward and prayed, O Lord God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, Let it be known today that you are God in Israel, and that I am your servant, and have done all these things at your command. Answer me, O Lord. Answer me, so these people will know that you, O Lord, are God, and that you are turning their hearts back again. Then the fire of the Lord fell and burned up the sacrifice, the wood, the stones, and the soil, and also licked up the water in the trench. That's amazing. This is probably the highlight of Elijah's life. He never saw a miracle this great. He did many miracles, but this is just showmanship. This is like a fancy miracle. And it's causing amazing things to happen. These are the things that happen. I've had seasons like this. I've seen revivals in my ministry. I've seen just many, many people come, get saved, healed, touched. We've seen miracles, amazing things. In those seasons, you feel like you are a kite flying in the sky and the Lord has the string. Everything is perfect and you're happy. And you experience number four, great success. When all the people saw this, they fell prostrate and cried, "The Lord, He is God! The Lord, He is God!" It wasn't really a hard choice to make. Then Elijah commanded them, "Seize the prophets of Baal. Don't let anyone get away." They seized them, and Elijah had them brought down to the Kishon Valley and slaughtered there. And that was not exactly an act of mercy, but in those days it was a different age. And he was also cleansing the nation, because those people came in, corrupted and perverted everything. In the good season, everything we do results in great success. Elijah was in the prime of his life. Everything's going great. I pray today. I wish we could just stop the message right here and say, amen, hallelujah, this is your life. God is going to give you great success. And if I were in a lot of prosperity churches, this is exactly where I would stop and say, hallelujah, God has made you a head and not a tail. He blessed you coming in and going out. He's going to prosper you, and He will bless you. And He told me that you will never fail, and you will not fall. And you see, this is not the kind of things that Jesus teaches. Jesus said, look, there's going to be tribulation. There's going to be problems. You're going to go through trials. The early church said, only through much tribulation. There's problems. If we are only geared up to be good believers during the good seasons, we will not remain a believer. We will fall away when the trials come. We will simply be like that 25%, actually 75% of those that hear the word in the parable of the sower, receive it with gladness. But it's like seed on the road, and the devil comes and eats it away. The seed that fell among the thorns and the rocks, it says there that it's the cares of this life, the troubles and the persecution. When it comes, it chokes out the seed. These are people that are not really living as good ground Christians, because they only praise God and serve God in the happy times. I've seen people in this church, I've seen people come and be touched by God, rejoice in the presence of the Lord, be happy, have their lives turned inside out, upside down, dreams and visions, Jesus visiting them in the night, and then just a few weeks later deny Christ outright. Seen it right here in this church. It happens. It's heartbreaking, but we need to be ready not just for these good times where God is doing everything for us, but also when there's bad times. Because I'll tell you this about these seasons. As I said earlier, we don't control them. God is in control of the seasons. And He loves you so much, He does not just give you good seasons. He gives you the bad seasons. He gives you the difficulties, the trials. And that's part two, Elijah out of season. We see here seven things about being out of season. Sounds like a lot. It's not going to take that long. Now, this is, by the way, immediately following what we just read. Like, literally, just stepping into the next chapter, it says in 1 Kings 19:2. So Jezebel sent a messenger to Elijah to say, "May the gods deal with me, be it ever so severely, if by this time tomorrow I do not make your life like that of one of them," referring to the prophets of Baal that were slaughtered. This is the queen. This is Ahab's wife, Jezebel. And she speaks these words. And number one about this time is man's word will lead us into this off season. Notice that it started the good season, God's word. When God speaks, there's a good season when you're listening. But most bad seasons happen when you hear a negative report or somebody speaks something. And God lets you hear this so that you can be tested in your resolve and your focus and your dedication. This is the great man of God. I don't think any of us have ever done any kind of exploits like Elijah. He's amazing. 14 major miracles in his lifetime. Incredible things that he did. And yet now suddenly, watch the difference. This woman sends this message and tells him this. And this first God spoke, but now people are speaking. Beware of the servants of Satan. Jezebel was a pawn of Satan. You think, well, would God do that? Well, God did that to Job also to test him. Satan was employed to go and test him. He just said, you can do anything, but don't kill him. And he did to see what was in his heart. So now we see the same thing. Number two, fear comes in the off season. Remember, you were fearless before, but look at this. The same man, same prophet, same powerful man of God. It says Elijah was afraid and ran for his life. When he came to Beersheba in Judah, he left his servant there, afraid and ran for his life. You have to ask yourself, why? Why was he not the same as he was just a moment ago, valiantly standing in the face of the king, and now this woman, Jezebel, is threatening him, and he's fearful for his life and runs away. She sent a word and said it. Some people said because there's nothing scarier than a woman. Maybe that's related. I don't know. I don't know. I mean, there for me, I fear God. And right below that, I fear Barbara. It's very close. God slightly outranks her, but she's way up there. But this is not a pauper. This is a Jezebel. This is a wicked woman that was perverse and twisting everything to get her own way and to exploit situations. She was evil. And fear comes. We're in that off season. We have to wrestle with fear. But you think, well, you know, the Bible says God hasn't given us a spirit of fear. We don't have a spirit of fear, but it does not mean that we will not have fear. There are different kinds and calibers of fear. There's natural fear, the kind of fear that tells you not to dance on the edge of a cliff. That's natural. That's not a demon spirit. Oh, a spirit of fear jumped on me. Why? Because I was standing on the edge of a cliff and I got scared. No, that's God's instinct in you to protect your life. But irrational fear is the devil's fear. And it is allowed to work as a tool in your life to perfect you. And he will send it. God will allow it to take place. Just like this man of God, from one extreme to the other, now suddenly is fearful for his life. I can only conclude that God was allowing it to happen. To prepare him and to protect him. And we're going to see that. But fear is a catalyst of growth and development. No doubt. It's a tool that can make you reevaluate yourself. Your self-assessment changes. It adjusts your self-image and causes you to mature. Eric was just testifying about it. When you go and you put out there, and Eric was on the cusp of absolute truth on the mission field. 21 days is absolute truth on the mission field. It takes 3 weeks to make a habit, right? People on a missions trip, I see weekend warriors all the time going on mission trips, and they just know they could be a missionary. Hallelujah. We went, we did this, we did that, and we accomplished. And I'm like, yeah, right. That's great. I applaud them. But it, man, after you've been there for about a month, things look different. And you need to decide, why are you there? Because God sent you. There's an off-season coming. And it happens for missionaries. It happens in life. It happens in business. Happens in your educational career. Happens in marriages. Happens in any friendship. There's off-season and there's on-season. There's good times and there's bad times. But we need to stay focused on the Lord. But he's going to adjust your image. Remember that God has not given you that fear. But he does use it as a tool. The enemy has always been a pawn in the hand of God. Number three, we want to die in the off season. While he himself When a day's journey into the desert, remember, he just left his servant, he's by himself. He came to a broom tree, sat down under it, and prayed that he might die. "I've had enough, Lord," he said. "Take my life. I'm no better than my ancestors." Then he lay down under the tree and fell asleep. How many of you have ever done this? I'm going to raise my hand. I've done it a few times. I've been in such despair that I just no. But you know, it's interesting that my conclusion was the same as his. I just went to bed. I just had enough. And literally, "I have had enough, Lord." And that's the good thing about sleep. Sleep is like restarting a computer so you can reboot it when it jams up. Just go to sleep. When you wake up, things seem a little better. Sometimes they seem worse. That's why people who are depressed will sleep 12 to 15 hours a day. They just want to hide and go to sleep. But here he wants to die. He wants to just die. He doesn't care. He just had enough. And that's part also of us understanding what we're made of and who we are and how we are, so that our dependence will not be upon ourselves but on the Lord Jesus Christ. He's our only hope. He's our only source. To him be all the glory and the honor and praise forever for sustaining us and maintaining us in every season. We want to die because we're supposed to die. The Bible says, and I'm not talking about physical death. This is just a desire to die. Elijah probably was not so serious. He was exaggerating. "Just kill me." You know, when people exaggerate and they say that, we do the same. I feel like I'm dying. You're not dying. You're just looking for a change. Perhaps Elijah had grown overconfident in his ability. Who knows? Number four, supernatural strength comes in our off season. All at once, an angel touched him and said, "Get up and eat." He looked around, and there by his head was a cake of bread baked over hot coals and a jar of water. He ate and drank and then lay down again. The angel of the Lord came back a second time and touched him and said, "Get up and eat, for the journey is too much for you." So he got up and ate and drank. Strengthened by that food, he traveled 40 days and 40 nights until he reached Horeb, the mountain of God. There he went into a cave and spent the night. So we know that Elijah cried out to God. He despaired of his life. He fell asleep. And God responded, because supernatural strength comes in the off season. And I thought about this when I read it. I've had good seasons. I've had bad seasons. But you know what? I carefully thought this. I have had no major encounters with God in my good seasons over 30 years. Never in the high times have I had like a visitation from God that really changed my course and my life. It's always been in my misery. Always been when I wanted to die, so to speak. That's when God comes. Years ago, I was running and I was on the way to a church that day. I was exercising in the morning and I had a message prepared. But the Spirit of the Lord came to me while I was jogging down the road, and the Lord says, "Where can I be found?" Strange question. Back then, I still answered questions when God answered. You know, I've told you now, my secret, don't answer a question that God asks you. He's not looking for an answer. He's trying to teach. It's rhetorical. He's trying to teach you something. But then I would answer. And he said, "Where can I be found?" And of course I said, "In prayer, in worship, in the Word of God." And God's like, no, I'm not talking about that. No. And the Spirit's speaking to me. I'm still running. And he said, "I'll tell you where I can be found. Three places. At the end of your rope, in the middle of the battle, and in the depths of your heart." When he said it, the power of God hit me. I literally stumbled and fell while I was running into someone's green grass yard and wept in the power of God. That morning I went to that church. That's the message I preached. Exactly what he told me. And the altar filled with people sobbing uncontrollably. They were all at the end of their rope in the middle of a battle. And God touched them in the depths of their heart. A revival broke out in that church. Because it's true. God doesn't come to you in happy, good times, and the change, the development of you comes during these hard times. And He provides for you. He feeds you a cake that gives you strength that is not your own. The supernatural presence of God gives you supernatural food that is in spirit, from the Word, the revelation, whatever it is He gives you, and you find strength where you had no strength, and you're able to continue. And that's why you learn to depend upon God in those seasons. Number five, the Word of the Lord comes. And the Word of the Lord came to him, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" He replied, "I have been very zealous for the Lord God Almighty. The Israelites have rejected your covenant, broken down your altars, and put your prophets to death with the sword. I am the only one left. Now they're trying to kill me too." Here the prophet is hearing God speak to him. God will give you a word that means something. He will interact with you in the off season in a way that He would never in the good season. He speaks to you, He communicates with you, but it's very different. Very different during the hard times. Number six, the Lord visits us in the off season. The Lord said, "Go out and stand on the mountain in the presence of the Lord, for the Lord is about to pass by." And at this point, he goes out and he's standing on the mountain, and a great wind blows so strong it knocks the rocks down off the mountain. And the Bible says the Lord was not in the wind. Then there's an earthquake. The whole mountain shakes, and the Bible says, but the Lord was not in the earthquake. And then there's a fire. A holocaust sweeps over the mountain, and the Bible says, but the Lord was not in the fire. And then it says, a still, small voice, a gentle whisper. And that was God. God teaches you things in your time of despair, in your hardships, that you would never learn. Elijah was used to the fancy power. God, I think that's why he did it. He caused the storm and the wind and the earthquake and then the fire and said, "No, that's not me, that's not me, that's not me." Maybe Elijah was tuned that way, to think God is this powerful, spectacular God that only operates this way. But God spoke in a gentle whisper. "What are you doing here, Elijah?" Got his attention. Number seven, go straight to that one. We are restored and improved in the off season. The Lord said to him, "Go back the way you came and go to the desert of Damascus. When you get there, anoint Hazael king over Aram. Also anoint Jehu son of Nimshi king over Israel. And anoint Elisha son of Shaphat from Abel-Meholah to succeed you as prophet. Jehu will put to death all those who escaped the sword of Hazael, and Elisha will put to death any who escaped the sword of Jehu. Yet I reserve 7,000 in Israel, all whose knees have not bowed down to Baal, and all whose mouths have not kissed him." Here the prophet Elijah sees the whole reason why he went through this season. It has been preparing him. This is the last mission given to him by God. Anoint Elisha to take your place. His next stop was heaven by a fiery chariot that literally came down, picked him up. He's the only man to be taken off the face of the earth that way. Enoch walked and was not. We don't know the details of actually how Enoch was taken, but this is clear later in the story. A fiery chariot, the greatest experience, the culmination of everything he ever did and was, happened. That's the restoration of God. And that's what comes at the end of that off season. The Lord was preparing. Remember that we are in a seasonally oriented process of development. Don't despair in the winter. Also remember that when winter is coming, you need to prepare during the good. That's why I'm always telling you, when the Spirit of the Lord is moving in the services, seek the Lord while He may be found. Call upon Him while He's near. While you're at the oil merchant, buy extra oil. Remember the wise and the foolish virgins. When their Spirit is moving, if you are only visiting for a moment in a place where God's Spirit is pouring out, better fill everything. Let your little fingers be saturated with God's power. Everything, because there are seasons coming. Well, you will not have. Remember Jesus at one point said that to them? There was a moment in your life when I'm with you. As long as the bridegroom is with them, you're not going to fast. The time's coming that you will fast. The off seasons were coming. So we prepare for that, we get ready, we learn principles, we learn these concepts that will keep us steady through it all. And I've lived this pattern again and again in the last over the last 30 years. These are the things we saw. In season, four things about being in season: communication with God, respect and honor, fearlessness and faith, great success. Whenever I hear somebody in the Christian faith really talking a lot about how great they are in God, I know, man, your out season's on its way. Remember, the proud, God sees them in a certain way. I know sometimes you think, well, you know, Stephen, you're always talking down on yourself and saying this, and like what Eric said, that was one of the best things I've ever heard. Some people might think, you're oriented to self-exaltation. You would think, you know, that, oh, that's not good. He's suffering from low self-esteem. That's not truth. He's finding truth. Because in our weakness, God is strong. And that's why if you go through this season, you come back to this season, man's word leads you into the off season. Somebody tells you something and you start to feel a way that fear comes. You just want to die. But just when you're at the point of wanting to die, supernatural strength comes. I got to this point when I was first saved after the first year. And I'm going to close with this story. Then I'm going to pray for some people. First saved, it was all that first thing that we saw, that up season, the good season. You know, we already know what it is. And I had such a great time in my honeymoon in Christ. And I was so proud of myself. I learned the Bible faster than anybody around me. I memorized chapter after chapter. Still this day, I can recite whole chapters verbatim because I was such an avid Bible studier. And I did more than anyone else. And I stood head and shoulders above everyone, and I was this great guy, and all kinds of accolades and praise from the people in the church. Amazing man of God. He's gone places. He's going to do great things. The Lord encouraged me. Prophets would come and single me out and say, man of God, God's going to use this man. And I would be like, yes, thank you, thank you. Yes. You know, I'm really humble and proud of it. Just had the attitude. But then things changed, and I went into a dark season, a dry season. And I even got to the point where I felt incapable of living the Christian life. And the moment came that I was working a job in the country, away from the city, and I was in a caravan, a little camper. And in that camper, I had a meeting with God, and I got on my knees, and I told God that I could no longer be a believer. I said, I can't do it. I can't do this. I've tried. I've done everything within my power. Reading the Word, all this, and I fear that I am nothing. At that time, I didn't know that that was a plus. I fell down. And all by myself, I began to weep and weep and weep. So much so that my body went into a fetal position. You know, when you really cry, when your soul pours out. And I wrapped around a center column post on a little table in that camper and just hugged it, and by myself in the dark under that table, I cried and cried and cried. I wanted to die. Right then, God came in that camper. Spirit of the Lord filled. He touched me, and he told me, he explained some things about everything I had done and how I put a lot of trust in myself, and that's not his design. He never asked me to be the things that I had become. And I felt release. I felt strength. And I even went back to church that following week, and I hadn't been in a few weeks, which, you know, my testament, it's very unusual for me to miss any services, but that was the only time I skipped church, like three weeks. And I used to sit in the front with my little tie on and my Bible and, you know, just Holy Joe. But now I went to church with a t-shirt on and I hid in the back of the church. I was embarrassed to even be there. I felt unworthy. I was literally, you know, have mercy on me, a sinner. I was that guy. In the back of the church, I hid because I didn't want the pastor to see me because I was so ashamed that I was nothing. The pastor was preaching his message, and in the middle of his message, he stopped. And he said, "Where's Stephen?" And there were 250 people in the room. He did not see me. He said, "Where's Stephen?" And people started looking around where I usually sat. They didn't see me, but people saw me in the back. They spotted me. They were like pointing. You know, they'll give you up in a heartbeat. They're like, "He's back here." You know, and I was hiding and didn't. And he said, "Stephen, come here. The Lord spoke to me. Come here, quick, quick." And I got up and obeyed. I went to the front of the church. And he said, "This past week," he said, "I see you," and he spoke, he said, "I see you in a tiny room." He said, "You're weeping. You're pouring your heart out. In fact, it's not a tiny room. It's like a caravan or a camper in your own hands." And by then, I was like, "Oh, how would he know that?" It was supernatural. And he said, "And you're balled up under a little table, and you're telling God you can't go on. And you're telling him that," you know, he like repeated some of the things I actually prayed. Blew my mind. Now I'm standing in the front weeping. And he says, "I'm here to tell you that you now are stronger and greater than you've ever been before. And that God has promoted you to the right understanding about his kingdom. And you're going to Bible school," because that was the plan. My next step was to go to Bible school. At that time, I'd given up on that. I was not going to do any of that. Not going to be what I am today. And he said, "You're going to Bible school is because of what God has taught you, what he will teach you in these days, you will be a greater star going into that Bible school than most of them will be coming out." And, of course, that sounds like pride, but I was happy to hear it. Needed that encouragement. And I kept that attitude. I would have never had that experience if I didn't go through that season. I pray for you to be blessed. I pray for you to have great seasons in your life. But I pray more that God have his will and his way done in your life. That when you go through those trials, just remember to yield to the Lord. Just don't quit. Just keep going. Keep yielding to him. And God will do great things in you. In your life, in your heart, and everything that you do.